This screencast focuses on the relationship between potential energy diagrams of reaction coordinates and reaction kinetics. And so in courses as early as high school chemistry, we learn to start looking at reactions in terms of potential energy diagrams, where we have reactants that have to cross some kind of energy barrier in order to form products. And we would expect that the rate with which reactants go to form products is fundamentally related to this energy landscape. And we want to try to explore what that relationship is in this screencast through the development of what's known as the Eyring equation. To keep things simple, we'll look at a very simple gas phase reaction, and that's the isomerization between CNH and HCN. And so we can draw what the stable reactant and product structures of that reaction look like. We can also imagine what the transition state might look like. Since this reaction involves a hydrogen atom basically swapping sides of the molecule, you might expect that the transition state involves the hydrogen being basically halfway across the CN molecule on its way to being attached actually to the carbon instead of the nitrogen. And so we might propose that this is a transition state structure. It turns out we can actually use, for example, quantum chemical software packages to compute various forms of the energy of these kinds of molecules. So, for example, we'll be able to compute quantities like the Gibbs free energy, the enthalpy. We can use statistical mechanics relations to compute the entropy, and so forth. And so by having these approximate structures for the reactant, transition state, and product forms of CNH, we can compute this energy landscape, or these positions on the energy landscape. And so we kind of want to know, well, how will we use that information to actually tell us something about the reaction rate? So the central idea behind transition state theory is that we can determine the concentration, the density of molecules in a given vessel volume that are in the transition state by assuming an equilibrium relationship with the concentration of reactant molecules, which is much easier to measure. So we expect that the density of transition state molecules, because they're highly energetic, is very low within the reaction vessel. It's something that's going to be difficult for us to measure, whereas we know in general the concentration of reactants that we've loaded. And so that's a measurable quantity. And therefore, it's useful to keep track of this concentration of the transition state in terms of this assumed equilibrium relationship. This is a key assumption in transition state theory. So it's only technically true that we expect an equilibrium relationship between stable states, so between, say, reactants and products. And the transition state has some of the properties of a stable state in that because it's at a maximum in the energy, the derivative of energy with respect to the reaction coordinate is zero at that maximum, just like it is for the reactant or the product state. But the second derivative has a different sign. Here we have a maximum instead of a minimum. And so we don't expect rigorously that an equilibrium relationship will necessarily apply, but we're going to use it as a model, and it has been used effectively, this kind of equilibrium relationship, in order to predict reaction rates. And so the approach in transition state theory is that we're going to determine the rate of product formation in terms of some kind of rate constant times the concentration of the transition state. And that rate constant takes this particular form. It's often called the crossing frequency, where we multiply Boltzmann's constant times the temperature over H times the concentration of the transition state. The idea here is that once we've achieved enough energy to produce this transition state and we've come up to this maximum on the potential energy surface, right now we don't need any more energy for the molecule to fall into the product state where the hydrogen is next to the carbon. And really, the rate with which we form product from the transition state is just related to how long it takes for the hydrogen to traverse from this position to the reactant. And that ends up being a very fast reaction rate. This rate constant is approximately 10 to the 13 reciprocal seconds when you plug in temperatures of around 500 Kelvin and the values for Boltzmann's constant and Planck's constant. All right, and this quantity comes from an analysis that involves the kinetic theory of gases. And we won't talk about where that comes from today. We'll just accept it. And we'll use another screencast to deal with what is known as the crossing frequency comes from. But in any case, it's a very large number. And again, that's because it really only relies on, since we've achieved enough energy for the molecule to reach the transition state, it's just how long does it take to actually fall down into the product state. So we're going to use this equilibrium constant inside this relationship, and just to make it clearer that we're talking about a transition state, I'll use the typical double dagger formalism to denote that particular pseudo-equilibrium constant. All right, we can substitute in the top expression into the bottom one to write down an expression for the reaction rate. And when we see that when we do that, we get this collection of constants in the temperature that we know the values of for any given experiment where we would conduct, that we'd conduct at a particular temperature. We then have this equilibrium constant that we'll deal with in just a minute. And now, instead of the concentration of the transition state, we've substituted in for the concentration of the reactant, which is something that's easy for us to measure. And in fact, this has sort of a classic form that this entire quantity we can refer to as a reaction rate constant. And we see, therefore, that the reaction rate is equal to this reaction rate constant times the concentration of the reactant, which is the form of the reaction rate that we are used to using for a first order reaction. So we're interested in evaluating this reaction rate constant K. We can again just express this in terms of the crossing frequency. And then this equilibrium constant we can re-express based on the definition of an equilibrium constant that is equal to the exponential of negative delta G for the reaction of going from reactants to transition state over RT. And so if on our potential energy diagram we are actually plotting the Gibbs free energy, then the quantity that we need is this value, which is the difference in the Gibbs free energy between the reactants and the transition state. And we see that if we have this value, we can actually plug it straight into this exponential. And if we know the temperature, all we have to evaluate this expression are the constants, the Boltzmann's constant and Planck's constant. And therefore, we can evaluate the rate constant completely from this potential energy diagram. To do this, we would just have to use, for example, a quantum chemical software package to estimate the Gibbs free energy of the reactants and the Gibbs free energy of the transition states by inputting this linear structure CNH and this triangular structure transition state and computing their Gibbs free energies. Now, there's another transformation that's often useful, and that's to recognize that delta G is equal to delta H minus the temperature times delta S. And if we just use that relationship and plug it into the expression, then we get this expression at bottom, where we've introduced now two variables instead of one, so in a way we've added complexity. But the reason this is done is that it turns out delta G is strongly dependent on temperature, whereas delta H to the transition state has a very weak temperature dependence. And so we get a constant here that doesn't depend very strongly on temperature. And what we can see is that there's a fundamental similarity here between this expression for the rate constant and the empirically derived or empirically determined Arrhenius expression for a rate constant, where we have a temperature independent activation energy divided by RT that we're taking the exponential to, times a pre-exponential factor that is nominally assumed to be a weak function of temperature in the Arrhenius expression. We see that delta S to the transition state and, of course, the temperature itself, those are both actually temperature-dependent quantities, obviously, in the case of the temperature here. This is not an exact correlation, that A is not exactly equal to this collection of terms, and the activation energy is not exactly equal to delta H to the transition state. But as we'll show in a future screencast, they actually are pretty close in most cases. And so you can understand the activation energy is coming mostly from the enthalpy difference between the transition state and the reactants, whereas the pre-exponential factor is dependent mostly on the entropy difference between the transition state and the reactants. And we see that these dependencies have opposite signs inside the exponential. And that makes sense because we expect that as entropy goes up, that's a more favorable process, a more probable process, and so the rate will tend to go up. Whereas as the enthalpy of the transition state goes down, it's easier to have molecules achieve that enthalpy, and so we expect that that will increase the rate of reaction. And that's the reason for the opposite signs there. All right, this is an expression that is, again, has several assumptions associated with it, but has actually been found to be extraordinarily useful and accurate in many applications that people care about in predicting rate constants based on just understanding the structures and energies of the reactants in the transition states.